فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على من أرسله الله رحمة للعالمين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. وعنوى كتاب الورقات للإمام أبي معالي الجويني رحمه الله إمام الحرمين. We've took last lesson أقسام العلم and we spoke about علم الضروري with the شرح of Abdullah ibn Salih al-Fawzan. إن شاء الله تعالى we're now going to talk about العلم النظري in details إن شاء الله تعالى in the شرح of Abdullah ibn Salih al-Fawzan. العلم النظري, which is a second type of knowledge, علم النظري, ويسمى, and it's also called العلم المكتسب. It's also called علم المكتسب, which is the knowledge which you gain. وهو علم النظري, and علم المكتسب is ما يقع, that which falls عن نظر واستدلال. It occurs by you coming with what? نظر, observation. والاستدلال, and looking for evidence. He's now going to explain to you what Abi al-Imam al-Haramain meant when he said ma yaqa'u. Ma yaqa'u ay ma yahsulu. That which you will gain through it min al-ilmi in terms of knowledge. So the ma here is jins. Jinsu fi al-ta'rif. Meaning it falls under the definition. Wa qawluh, and his speech. An, wa qawlihi an nadharin. Observation. When you use the word, then that which you gain from observation, what automatically leaves? علم الضروري. Because علم الضروري, you don't gain it by observation. قيدٌ, it's a point, يخرج العلم الضروري, which exits and gets rid of the علم which is ضروري. علم الضروري does not occur by نظر. Good. لأنه, why, how does it occur علم الضروري؟ لأنه, because حاصل عن غير نظر. It occurs without you having to observe. مثل, like, العلم بأن المذي نجس. Such as the knowledge that the مذي is نجس. There are three things that come out from a person. A male or a female. What are they? المذي والوذي and والوذي. مني, مذي and وذي. These are the three. Those three that I just mentioned, the مني is not نجس. The مني is not نجس. Meaning if the مني goes on your clothes, the مني will not make your clothing dirty. You don't have to wash it off, huh? Because it's not impure. That is the mani. The mavi, mavi, if it goes on your clothing or it goes on you, you have to wash your private part. The wadi also is the same as the mavi, which is that if it goes on your clothing or on you, it makes you, it is impure, you have to wash yourself from it. You have to wash yourself from it. Pay attention. The first one I mentioned from those three is many. Many comes after intimacy or a wet dream. And it comes out with pleasure. And you feel it when it comes out because it comes out with pleasure. Normally when it comes out, it jumps. It jumps out. Lakin, that's the many. But it's not impure. But you become impure. You, but you become impure. The mani, when it comes out, you become impure. You have to have a bath. It comes with dirt joy. The mavi does not come out because of pleasure. It is a after the pleasure, it comes out from you. Or it comes out, if a man, for example, he erects and it goes down again, it comes out And he may not feel it. He may not feel it coming out. Okay? The wadi, it comes after working. When you lift something up and you work a lot, or the weather is very cold, or you go to the toilet, urinate, wadi just comes out. Lakin the madhi comes out from when there was desires and nothing happened and it goes down, the madhi comes out. The person doesn't know that it came out. But whenever they see it, they have to wash their private parts. So how do you know this knowledge? It requires what? That the madhi is impure. How do you find out? Hanavar. Observation. You have to look at the text. Also, وَأَنَّ الطَّوَافَ الْوَدَعِ The طَوَافُ الْوَدَعِ which is the tawaf you do, is called the farewell tawaf. It is obligatory. Can somebody know that by daruri knowledge? Or does he need observation into the text? He needs observation. Also, which is, عِلْمُ النَّظَرِ is also what? أَنَّ الْإِجَارَ That ijara, which is renting, عَقْدٌ is a contract which is lazim. Inshallah ta'ala, when we go to Mu'amalat, the chapter of Mu'amalat in our book, Umdatul Ahkam, which we're doing right now, we will learn that the uqud, the transaction that people do, there is aqd which is called lazimul tarafaini. Lazimul taraf. And lazimul tarafaini, which means what? There are uqud, a transaction that two people do. Both of the two parties have to hold on to this contract. They can't leave it. For example, if a person rents a house to you, he rents a house to you. The house in which he has rented to you, lazim, and you've signed that contract. You signed a 1-year contract. The day you signed it, the next day, the person who you rented it for, or you rented it for yourself, you passed away. You died. The owner of the house, what does he do? If he doesn't want to terminate that contract, and he still wants that rent to be given to him, or the money was already given to him, he took it from you, he can say to you, I don't care, I will not break the contract. Because it's lazim al-tarafain. Both parties have to stick to it. So what does that person, his children, his offspring, they reside in it. They benefit from it. If he chooses to say, okay, I understand your circumstances have changed. Here's your money. You guys can leave now. But what are they allowed? They are allowed to rent the house. They don't want to benefit from it. They are allowed to sublet it. In the Sharia, they let it. If he forgives them, inshallah, we're going to come to it. It's called Iqala. It is called Iqala. And when we come to Bab, Uqud, you can do Ihsan. The same way is when you marry a woman. You can't just marry a woman and then just walk out the other day and say, I'm not in this contract. I'm not talking about divorce. Divorce is another matter. But the man can't say, take your daughter back, I don't want her anymore. If he says, I divorce her, that's something else that is nothing to do with the contract. So there's something called lazim al-tarafain. Both parties have to stick by. You marry a man's daughter, you can't say, oh, I'm not going to let her stay in the house. She can walk around the block and the area. And whenever I need her, I'll call her until she comes over to me. That wasn't the condition. Every person who makes a contract with two parties, if both parties have taken this contract together, lazim, both parties have to hold it to the contract. If a person allows the other person to break the contract, then sometimes that contract can be one-sided. And it only obliges one person and not the other. That person who signed that contract with that person, who made the contract one-sided, he has to fulfill that contract. He cannot break it. So what do we find? علم النظري, how does it occur? And yeah. لازم الطرفين. Okay. علم النظري. What did he define it as? عَرَّفَ النَّظَرَ وَالْاِسْتِدْلَالِ He defined ilm al-nadhari and explained it to you, Abi Ba'ali al-Juwayni. But after that, what did he do? He now defined for you a nadhar and istidlal. Nadhar means what? Observation and looking for evidence. What are they? What is nadhar and what is istidlal? We need them. Because they are both present in which one? علم النظري. And they are both absent from which one? علم الضروري. لأنهما واقعان في تعريف العلم الضروري نفيا والمكتسب إثباتا. It's important. So let's take each one. What does nadhar mean and what does istidlal mean? Because why? Why do we need to know? Because the nadhar and istidlal were negated from علم الضروري and they were affirmed for what? علم النظري. So you have to know what they are. First take علم النظري. What does nadhar mean then? What does nadhar mean? Nadhar means two meanings. يطلق على معانٍ. Many meanings are given to it, but we're only going to take two. You'll find the word nadhar is used for many meanings. But two so far are the most famous. One is ru'yatul ayn, the seeing with the eye is called nadhar. Seeing with something with your eyes is called nadhar. Also, al-fikru, your thoughts, is called nadhar as well. And the second one is the one that is intended here. Observing it with your mind. Thinking about something. Pay attention. This is a very important point. Very, very important. That is what it is linguistically. The word nadhar linguistically. What does it technically mean? Technically, the author explained it to you. What is it? هُوَ الْفِكْرُ It is to think. فِي حَالِ الْمَنْظُورِ فِيهِ It is to look at. Pay attention. Abdullah ibn Salih al-Fawzan says, Ayat tafkir is to think fi shay'i in the matter which you're looking at. You've taken this thing and you're looking at it and you're thinking about it. Your brain is working on the thing that you're going to pay attention. Why are you looking at, why are you thinking of it? Talaban li ma'rifati, because you're looking to understand the reality of it. Pay attention. Why would you do that? لأن النظر, because the thinking هو الطريق, it is the path إلى معرفة الأحكام الشرعية. It is to, it's one of the ways to know, or it's the way to know the أحكام of the Sharia, the rulings of the Sharia. The نظر is a way to know the rulings of the Sharia. إِذَا تَمَّتْ شُرُوطُهُ But that is when the conditions are present in you. What does that mean? He's going to mention to us, what are they? And take it them. One. The person who's allowed to think by looking at an evidence is a person whose conditions are present in him. Other people are not allowed to do that. وَهِيَ And it is. أَن يَكُونَ النَّاظِرُ The one who is looking is a person. كَامِلُ الْآلَةِ He has the instrumental knowledge. He has the instrumental knowledge. What does that mean? He has the 12 fields of the language, he understands them. He knows nahwa. He knows sarf. He knows the three types of balagha, ilm al-bayan, ilm al-badi, ilm al-ma'ani. He has adab. He understands adab. He understands Allah al-musta'an. You know, a bit about the ash'ar and the urud and the qawafi, yes. He also knows usul al-fiqh. He knows Mustalah al-Hadith. He knows Qira'at and the Qur'an and the sciences of the Qur'an, and he knows Usul al-Tafsir. His Aqeed and his Tawheed is on point. That individual is a person who's alat, he has the instrumental. So that's one. That's one of the conditions that is needed in him. But then more of it will come to us in detail. So the first one is the individual who's looking. He has to have the instrumental knowledge. Sahih? The second thing is, وَأَن يَكُونَ نَظَرُ That he's thinking, the look that he's doing in terms of thinking, has to be fi dalilin, in evidence. What he's looking at has to be a dalil. Not a shubha, not a doubt. So what he's observing has to be a dalil. From the Kitab and the Sunnah. It has to be. Pay attention. وَأَن يَسْتَوْفِيَ الدَّلِيلِ وَيَعْرِفَ الشُّرُوطَ الْإِسْتِدْلَالِ He also has to have what? The third one is what? He has to also be able to what? Pay attention, brothers. All of the evidences regarding that matter have to be there for him. He can't be taking part of the evidences from the Sharia and forsake the others. Are you with me? So he brings up all the evidences regarding this matter. He puts it on the table. He says, are these all the evidences regarding this matter? Yes. And then what does he do? He looks at that, he does ijtihad, observation. He observes, nadhar. He thinks, he works his brain. He has the instrumental knowledge. He applies all the sciences that he knows on it. All of it, he lets it go on it. And then after that, what does he bring out of it? He brings out the ruling. Good. So do we know now what nadhar means? The second one is istidlal. What does istidlal mean? Wal istidlal wa qawluhu, the speech of the author, when he said, wal istidlal wa talabu dalili, the istidlal is looking for evidence. Istidlal means looking for evidence. Pay attention, he's getting it. Abdullah ibn Salih al-Fawzan al-Sharh is what I'm reading. Because that's what I promised at the beginning. As-seenu wa ta'u lit-talabi. Pay attention in the Arabic language. The seen and the ta' mean request. Ah. The word was what? Dalil. It was what? It was dalil. It became what? Istid. The seen and the ta' meaning is talab. Ah. Like the word. Istinsar, kalistinsar, looking for victory. How would you say it? It means talabun nusra, ay talabun nusra, to look for victory. It came from what? Istinsar came from what? Al nasr, victory. How do you say looking for victory? You say istin, you see, you put s and ta before it. It becomes what? Look, talab. So what does it mean? Wal muradu, what is meant by dalil? So we learnt what is meant by the seen and the ta, correct? Istidlal. We need to know what is dalil then. Ah. Dalil means what? Ma yustadallu bihi. It is what is used as evidence. Min nasin, from a text. Nas here means kitab and the sunnah. It means the kitab and the sunnah. Anything you will use as evidence from the kitab and the sunnah. Ah. Or ijma'in. Or ijma'. Ijma' is a? It's dalil. أو غيرهما or other than them or other than them is also قياس will also under fall under it and other than that which we'll go into more details inshallah ta'ala. Are you always with me now?
No.
ونظر نظر والاستدلال and استدلال بمعنى واحد they have one meaning, that's one view. They mean the same. Another والاستدلال, both of them mean what? One thing, that's one view. And what is the one meaning that they both have? وَهُوَ And that is أَنَّ كُلَّ مِنْهُمَا يُؤَدِّي إِلَى الْمَطْلُوبِ. Both of them will reach you to what you're looking for. Looking at something and observing will allow you to know what you're looking for. Looking for evidences will also allow you to know what you're looking for. Both of them have that meaning the same. They're both the same. وَجَمَعَ بَيْنَهُمَ الْمُصَنِّفِ And the Musannif, he combined both of them. فِي التَّعْرِيفِ الْعِلْمِ الضَّرُورِيُّ وَالْمُكْتَسَبِ تَأْكِيدًا And he said, the author, he combined between them two when he was talking about the definition of عِلْمُ الضَّرُورِي. Did he not say it? مَا لَا يَقَعُ النَّظَرِ وَاسْتِدْلَالِ Did he not say that about عِلْمُ الضَّرُورِي? That which occurs without nazar and istidlal, is that what he did? He not negate it from ilm al-daruri, both of them? So did he bring it both in there? Ilm al-nazari, did he also bring both of them in the definition? Yes, he has brought them both. One he brought it in terms of negating it, and one he brought it in terms of affirming it. Pay attention. Why did he do that? Abdullah ibn Salih al-Fawzan said ta'kidan. He only brought both of them to emphasize, because they both mean the same. That's why he did it. That's one view. Who believe that they both mean the same, and that's one view. The second view is, وَقَالَ بَعْضُهُمْ Some of the ulama, they said, النَّظَرُ نَظَر is أَعَمُّ مِنَ الْإِسْتِدْلَالِ is more broader than istidlal. نَظَر is more broader than istidlal. Is more broader. لِأَنَّهُ because يَكُونُ فِي التَّصَوُّرَاتِ وَالتَّصْدِيقَاتِ Because nadhar, it falls in at-tasawwurat and at-tasdiqat. That's why that the nadhar has a broader meaning than istidlal. Because in nazar, tasawwur and tasdiq fall under it. Whereas what? Istidlal, only tasdiqat fall under it. Only istidlal, only tasdiqat fall under it. Whereas another tasawwurat and at-tasdiqat both fall under it. Whereas istidlal is only specific to tasdiqat. Now the question is, what is at-tasawwurat and what is tasdiqat? I mentioned that last lesson, to be honest. There's no need for me to mention it again. But because I saw some of your faces drop, I'm going to explain it to you guys, inshallah. Tasawwurat means what? Idrakul khali anil hukmi. It is a perception of something without giving any ruling to it. Such as, for example, saying, this is sa'at. Khalas, that's tasawwur. I realize that this is sa'at, not oyun, no one else. Sa'ad, this is him. I know who he is. I perceived him. Lakin tasdiqat means what? I know he is Sa'ad, plus I have put a ruling on him. And what is the ruling? He is a reliable brother. Ah. So now what have I added? Tasdiq means ruling with it, sah? Are you with me? ولذلك, that's why the line of poetry, الإدراك من غير قضاء تصور ومعه التصديق وذاك مشتهر. I mentioned that line of poetry. Good. So nadhar, it encompasses both of those meanings that I mentioned. What does it encompass? Tasawwurat and tasdiqat. And that is, by the way, tasawwur and tasdiq is mainly spoken about the ulama of mantiq. They are the ones that speak about it. Ah. Whereas istidlal is specific to what? Tasdiqat. Tasdiqat means rulings. Istidlal is only rulings. Whereas another is perception plus rulings. So who's more broader? Nadar. That is istidlal linguistically. What does it mean technically? وَالدَّلِيلُ Dalil means what? هُوَ الْمُرْشِدُ Dalil means something that makes you reach, who guides you, sorry, murshid, guides you. إِلَى الْمَطْلُوبِ It guides you to what? To the thing that you want to know, or the thing that you're looking for, or the thing that you're requesting. The dalil is what guides you to it. Dalil is fa'ilun bima'na fa'ilun. It's the wazn in it, that it comes in terms of sarf, it's fa'il. And the meaning that is meant by it, it's fa'il. Which is from what? Min al-dalalati wa hiya al-irshad. It comes from dalala, which is fa'il. So the word dalil can be anybody who guides you. Anybody who guides you. So sorry, what we just took now was nazar and istidlal. Now we're taking dalil. Dalil. What we're taking now is dalil. Dalil is fa'ilun bima'na fa'ilun. And it comes from the word dalala. Dalala. Wa hiya al-irshad. Linguistically, the word dalil, linguistically, is general. And it means anybody who got anything that guides you to what you're looking for. I can be a dalil right now. I'm a dalil. If I take our brother Sa'ad by the hand and I take him to a destination he's looking for, I'm a dalil. Why? Because I've guided him to something which he's looking for, correct? But then technically, that's not what it means.